One common goal that these technologies have is to meet certain customer experience, okay? And these experiences are what let you connect to the customers. I'm going to share some of my learnings that I have building these customer experiences, and you know, I hope you guys enjoy it, okay? So before I begin, you know, I'll just play a video which talks about various customer experiences that we have built so far. May I have the video, please? Thank you. So you saw certain examples of the customer experiences. I'm going to take few examples out of it and share my experience, share my learning of how these customer experiences have helped client and the customers in large. So let me jump onto one first story. Okay. So this is about a brand which is one of the biggest investment advisory firm in the United States. When they approached us, their problem was simple, at least the way they stated it. They said that our customers feel that they know their risk appetite, but they really do not. And whenever we ask them, they talk a lot that, yes, I'm a risk taker. But whenever we put them on a fund which is risky, they always take wrong decisions. And they end up losing money. And when they end up losing money, they have a bad experience with us. What we did for them is that we said that if you want to really build a right customer connect, if you really want to know your customer well, you have to go beyond standard inputs. So this is the story of going beyond standard inputs. What we did is that we said that if you ask a customer on a web platform, say you can ask a few questions, they will reply. You can give a mobile app, they can answer a few queries. You get some surveys, you get some answers. But there's a limited amount of information that you get from there. The next thing to do is that you really give them an experience and you really monitor them using certain artificial intelligence things. So what we did is that we created a biometric-based application for them. This biometric application, what it does is that it observes the emotions and the you know, expressions of people when they are going through a stimuli. So we gave a stimuli. We let people experience with the stimuli, and while they were going through the experience, we were observing them. We were observing their face, we were observing their heart rate, and we were also observing the kind of level of stress they have using a wristwatch, using the camera of the device they are using, and also using a lot of simulated technology, which is like psychological questions. So this is how the interface looked like. And what we really learned is that 80% of the customers had wrong assessment of their own risk appetite. What we also understood is that most of the respondents, they came back and they said that now they trust the brand more because the brand has given them the right risk factor. And we also saw that this kind of technology helped us know a lot about people. Because we used a database of around 70 million emotions. We used a database across geography. We used databases which are across demographics, I would say. So the way I express my happiness, you know, if there's someone which is not an Asian, maybe they will express their happiness different way. So we analyzed those data, and that's where we were able to come up with this kind of a solution. So this is learning one, which was more about going beyond standard inputs. I'm going to talk about the next learning, which is breaking the language barrier. So I think all of us know here about multi-language applications, right? And this is one of the, I would say, basic ask, right? Everybody talks about we need to be multi-language. But what is the real importance of it, okay? Real importance of it comes when you try to penetrate into areas where the technologies has not reached. So one of the largest group called Adani and their investment firm, Adani Capital, they wanted to enable rural India to do business much and much better. And they approached us that the only way it is possible is through mobile apps. It is not possible by really creating web application or sending so many people, so many advisors there, or so many agents to collect the loan. So they wanted to take advantage of the high penetration of mobile apps and high penetration of mobile phones, which are there in rural India. So the first and simple thing we thought about them is that if you want to get into rural India, you need to be agnostic to the language, okay? You cannot just go with English language. Because the learnings that we had is, if we give an app to somebody who knows only Hindi or only Gujarati for that matter, they would take the app and give it to someone else and ask them to use on their behalf. And then they'll say that, please use it because I don't understand what is there. So you can make user interface as easier as possible, but it cannot really work unless it is in the native language. So we built the application for them. We tried multi-language, that is the one thing. We also tried a lot of interesting technologies there. We tried integration with Firebase real-time systems so that users are not required to update the app again and again, and we can make a lot of changes without apps being upgraded. We tried easy navigations, so which are like basic principles of UX. We tried 3 taps mechanism. So anywhere you want to, any information that you want to get from the app, you can get in 3 taps. So these were certain principles that we kind of followed while developing the app. And what we realized is that the penetration was too high. What we realized is that a lot of leads that the client might be losing earlier because they were not able to, you know, kind of pass on the information started coming on. The business grew, and the, you know, app was accepted with great fanfare. Next story. So this is about Helix opportunity. So here I'm going to talk about impact of inclusion, okay? So when I say inclusion, there are almost 1 billion people out there who need accessibility support. They are differently abled. They see system in a little different way than we see. Somebody who has a vision problem, you know, will have a totally different way of looking at the system than somebody who perhaps has arthritis and cannot type, right? So these were certain issues that were there, you know, and many organizations were kind of facing it. So the problem here was, how do we include them? Because if you try to create a system which is different, like everybody can create a narrator-based system, you know, that will speak up and, you know, people don't have to see the things. But the problem is that it is not at all including the entire community, which wants a kind of a holistic system. So let's see an example. So what we created is a learning management system. This learning management system gives actual feeling. So the people who cannot really visit a university, they get an actual feeling of a university. They see departments, they browse through those departments. While they are browsing through the departments, there is an assistant which is helping them. And all this experience is available as an immersive experience. So you can wear a headset and then try these experiences. You can go through the entire course, you can learn, and corporates can use this platform to create a learning management system for their employees. They can for their employees and for the people who will otherwise not be able to access it, you know, with the usual way. This application was launched, and you know, the things like creating the CGI models, things like creating the visual design, again the three-click theory, you know, integrating the you know one of the most successful LMS called Moodle, including. Including a lot of displays-related technologies, choosing the right color combination, working without, and you know, having a kind of an assistant which is always speaking and always guiding you through the application. These were certain principles that we followed, and we got great response from the application. There were a few people who actually said that you know we wouldn't have been able to you know use a learning management system the way unless this application was there. Next. Next story is about intelligent automation. So, you know, personal finance is, you know, as and when we are talking a lot about banking, we are talking a lot about, you know, how the different banks are using technologies and creating solutions for enterprises, solving payment processing time, solving loan disbursement time. At the same time, there has to be an equal focus given on the personal finance. So, personal finance is very, very important for every individual because you know the combination of this is what makes the entire economy stronger. So we worked with a client called Wally, and we created an app for personal finance. So when they approached us, they already had an app, okay, and the app was had quite good fanfare. App was successful, and you know, and they have been featured in a lot of leading you know papers. You can just Google for Wally and you would realize that they have more than 2.5 million downloads. They are available in more than 65 countries, and they are you know they have been rated as number one hyper personal financial app. So what you know, so somebody comes to you who is already successful, okay, and you know who has almost broken all types of startup records, okay, and who has been awarded so many times, and they come up with a problem of customer experience. They say that I'm not able to you know connect with my customers the way we want, okay. My customers are using the app, they are downloading it, but I still feel that we do not know so much about it. So the question I asked was that why do you think so? Why do you think that you are not able to know your customer well? So the answer which came is that we know what customers are spending and we know where they will spend, but we don't know we just do not know what to do with this data, and we do not know we cannot help them making savings better. We cannot help them guiding where they should spend, where they should not spend, and all these kind of things. So to connect better, what we did is that we used mathematical models and machine learning models on the data which were available. And we started predicting a lot of spending behavior of the customers. These behaviors gave us a lot of insights about you know what can be done, what cannot be done. So I'll give you a few examples of the insights that we got. One such insight was that, you know, we know that every month, say March 13th, this person actually buys something very expensive, okay? And it happens to be birthday of the person's wife. So now, if this person in February is planning to buy a car, we can send a notification, hey, your wife's birthday is coming up, okay? This is a time you should wait, not the right time to really spend money. So this is one example. Other example is that we know that a healthcare expense of this particular client is too high, right? So we try to kind of guide them that you are actually spending your money a lot on the healthcare related things, and these are and for that you need to kind of cut somewhere else, okay? Maybe you need to reduce your you know your food expenses, right? So these are certain kind of insights that we started kind of collecting. However, the challenge that we started facing with that is the information was not fully available. There were a few use cases for which we got the information, but for every use case, we did not have the information available. So what to do in that case? So what we did is that we spoke to platforms such as Yodlee. What it does is that it kind of integrates all the banks, and it provides the consumable APIs that you can use, call, and integrate in your apps. And you get, you know, a lot of transaction history. You kind of can link multiple bank accounts of individual customer. So we spoke to Yodlee and got some custom APIs done for Wally. These APIs, once integrated, brought in automation. So with Wally, what we tried to understand is that it is important to use the machine learning and AI models in such a way that it gives certain useful output, and it is also very important that there has to be certain kind of automation to be put so that the data can be collected correctly. Because if you do not collect the data correctly, or data is not inclusive, it is missing important parts, it is very difficult to, you know, derive relevant information out of it. So this terminology or this learning is what, you know, I kind of term it as intelligent automation. So we kind of use automation, we try to make it intelligent. So these were certain learnings that I had. I'll summarize it later. But before I start summarizing them, I want to talk about certain parameters, which are very, very important. See, creating a customer experience, or creating, for that matter, anything, is not complete unless you know how to measure it. So we claim that we create great customer experience. We should also know how to measure it. And there's a lot of theory. There is a lot of way. You know, marketing has gone too far to understand how to kind of measure customer experience. But these are certain parameters that we have used and which has helped us a lot to get the insight. So first thing is Net Promoter Score. Okay. So this is a simple formula which gives you an insight on whether how many of your customers are likely to promote other customers or bring in other customers on the platform. This is a great tool to understand your customer experience, because a happy customer will definitely bring two more customers. Another such thing is customer satisfaction. This is about an individual customer satisfaction, whether they are happy with everything what they are using or not. There's many ways of calculating it, but this is one thing which we must calculate. Next thing is about customer retention. It is about how long a customer remains with you. See, today, at least in the app world, it is quite common to, you know, push in a lot of digital advertisement, push in, you know, social media campaign, and people tend to download. There are a lot of people who are actually paying on downloads, right? So it's easy to acquire new customer. You get funding, you put some cost, and acquire your customers. However, the challenge is whether you retain them or not. So customer retention is one very important parameter every brand should kind of follow to understand the loyalty from the customer. Next is customer's lifetime value. So this is again related to customer retention, because it talks about in a certain time that or in an average time that customer remains with your platform, right? How much of the revenue is generated from that particular customer? It's again a very, very important parameter, because there are things that a customer may just download your app. The customer is your customer for a quite long time, but is not producing any revenue. If they are not producing any revenue, that means you have not been able to connect to the customer. Only way you are sure that the customer is connected, or you are connected with the customer, is when you are able to get good customer lifetime value. Last but not the least is customer effort score. This kind of talks about how easy or how difficult it is for a customer to use the service or consume the information that you are providing on your platform. So say, for example, of Adani app, the customer effort score there is very, very low because of the language barrier they have, that we have removed. If we talk about Helix, customer effort score is very, very less there, because even for those people who are differently abled, we have been able to create an accessible system. Right? So customer effort score is something which kind of helps you understand whether customer is doing the things easily or not. It's a measure of the user interface that you have created, measure of the technologies that you have used, measure of the automation which are inbuilt in the system, and measurement of how you are aggregating and, you know, kind of processing the information on your system. How is your information architecture? How is the flow? All that thing is decided by the customer effort score. So, summing it up, I think we have built so far more than 300 customer experiences. And out of that, these are some four learnings. So you will get lot of readings about what is, you know, how to build a great UI, how to build great user experience, how to use the best color combination, where to put what, where not to put, you know, A/B testing, and you know, many more. There are a lot of tools, but these are four learnings that we have got while building these experiences. Go beyond standard inputs. You have to think biometric. Today, a phone gets unlocked with your face. So biometric is the key. It's the future. Okay. With your touch, the devices get unlocked. The SDKs get unlocked. Be inclusive. Please do not leave those people who cannot access the system easily. Accessibility is very, very important. As of now, there are 1 billion people who cannot access the system properly. Then break the language barrier. Please go multilingual and use intelligent automation. So that's all about the learnings. And these learnings have resulted in a lot of success, which I can go on and keep talking about. Fivefold increase of orders via mobile for a leading e-commerce player in India. $8.3 million in management yearly savings for a leading hypermarket via mobile app. More than 2,800,000 bookings per month for a leading cab aggregator. More than 100 million download for second most, and the category of second most downloaded app in India on Play Store. More than 60% revenue generated through an app, you know, on the leading furniture retail, which is Paperfry. And 35% increase in net promoter score for world's leading brand. 800 million per month in downloads, in transaction for the foreign exchange trading company, and number one finance management app built for 22 countries. So that's all about building customer experience. That's all about the learning that I wanted to share.
Sure, great. Question time, any questions? No. Okay, I have one.
Okay.
So a lot of systems which you presented, or the experiences you presented, has been mobile tab based. How about all the other systems like smartwatch, Google Wear? How does that integrate into the overall experience?
Yeah. See. So when we are talking about building the customer experience, we should, as I said, we should go beyond standard inputs. Okay. So we should not think of just somebody, you know, using a phone and touching and providing you the input, or using the keyboard and mouse. Okay. So it's very important, I would say. Okay. You know, watch is getting very, very popular. Apart from watch, there are a lot of other, you know, kind of interfaces that are being built. Okay. Again, I'll insist a lot about biometric, because watch is also a biometric tool. Today it is able to capture a lot of biometric information about the people. Okay. Right from the heart rate. Okay. See, you know, if you give a watch to someone, they are wearing it, and you are able to know the heart rate, you know a lot about that person now. Okay.
Yeah,
and there's a lot that can be done with that information.
So have you done anything in that space which you want to share with everybody here?
Yeah, of course we have done. So what we have done is that there is actually a watch called Empatica, which we have used, and we have been able to kind of understand the motion of people with that, and we have created an app for elderly people. So in Canada, there is a big problem of elderly people falling and falling sick. Okay, so they actually fall a lot. Okay, I don't know for what reason, but with this kind of watch, what happens is that in case somebody falls, it can detect that the person has fallen, and it can pass on this information to a centralized server, and the action can be taken. So in fall is kind of a state of emergency, right? So it needs a quick response. So the response can be given quickly to save lives.